Greetings, everyone. I'm Karen Jane Casey, and this is Abundant Living with Karin. The underlying purpose of this podcast is to help us all to share the good news of Jesus, where there's hope for us, especially having a heart for the lost and the needy, while we struggle in a world of chaos. The thief comes to steal, kill, and to destroy, but Jesus came that we may have life and have it more abundantly. John 10:10. Please be assured that this 20-minute podcast or episode will not be lecturing down to anyone, and it will not be yelling or preaching at you. Rather, I share what I've learned, what I'm still learning in my journey, and what's on my heart through experience and reading the Word of God. We learn together. I welcome you to share what you've learned, and you can always contact me, CarinJaneCasey.com, CarinJayneCasey. Your testimony is important and someone does need to hear it. Let's start out by praying together. Dear Heavenly Father, King of the universe, because your loving kindness is better than life, our lips will praise you. You are our strength and our refuge. We are filled with gratitude and humility at the miracles you work in our lives. We cast our cares on you. We fear no evil because you are always with us. We pray faithfully and we strive to obey you consistently. We ask you to save, heal, and protect our family, our loved ones, our friends, our acquaintances, our community, our country, and even, Lord, we pray for our enemies, because we know with God all things are possible. We believe that you answer our prayers in your perfect will and your perfect timing. Please forgive us of our sins as we forgive those that have sinned against us. And Lord, help us in our journey so we'll be more like Jesus. Thank you for your unconditional love, compassion, and mercy. Your grace comes through Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, today's episode title is Be Transformed. Before we get into it, I'd like to share scripture references for your own study when you're moving along. So if you would, get a pen and paper ready so you can jot things down as you go. So what is the meaning of being transformed? This is a transformation or a dramatic change in the appearance or character of a person. A metamorphosis, a renewal of how a person thinks in their mind and in their heart. To be transformed is a process. It's a part of our life journey, our Christian walk. It may have many detours and potholes along the way as we continue to grow and to change. Some of you may know that I come from a lifetime of domestic violence as a child and then as an adult. I've been sharing my testimony for some time, and in it, I always praise God with gratitude for what he brought me through and what he brought me out of. God stepped in, and he brought my overcoming about. Lately, I've been looking at the entire testimony differently, with new eyes. That was a significant moment deep in the pit and close to losing my life that I cried out to the Lord, and he saved me. He scooped me up. He gave me a way of escape from my abuser while I was in a life-threatening situation, a dangerous and toxic environment. Psalms 40 verses 2 through 3 summarizes my story and many other people's story, and it's on the back cover of my book, My Dear Rosa Jean by Karin Jane Casey. I'm going to read it now. Psalms 40, verses 2 through 3. He brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and he set my feet upon a rock and established my steps. He has put a new song in my mouth, praise to our God. Many will see it and fear and will trust in the Lord. Now I more clearly see that the many significant times all along the way in my desperate need, he was there for me. I am filled with another layer of gratitude. And here are some examples. When my mother decided to beat me while I was a young child, and my father decided to do nothing, they essentially had abandoned me. But my Heavenly Father adopted me and protected my life. How do I know this? Because they did not kill me. They did not kill my brothers or sisters either. God taught each of us survival skills. For me, it was dissociation when the pain came, so it was bearable. And He gave me great courage when it was needed. While still very young, I recognized my parents were flawed in their thinking, perspective, and in their emotions. God enabled me. He implanted in me a tremendous desire to love and protect my siblings and to make right choices for their sakes. I took appropriate action when threats of violence were near. Not all of my choices that I made were right or good, but God was clearly working in the heart and mind of a young girl. It was God's hand in it all. I remember while I was a preteen and the twins were about 5 years old, several teenage boys in this rough, poor area that we lived in had grabbed my little sister and took her into a vacant house, into a bedroom. I was scared. I was terrified. Instead of being paralyzed with fear, though, God enabled me to storm in like a SWAT team of one and to defeat them all. A similar situation happened with my brother, saving our younger 5-year-old brother. All of this in such a rough, sometimes dangerous environment. God was with us. In February of 1975, I know it really shows how old I am, while I was a young mother and wife and in a broken home, I did accept the Lord as my Lord and Savior. But regardless, I made many mistakes along my path and I failed at relationships. My focus was on the world. We need to be loved and to be loved and accepted by people. My focus was not on Jesus and what inner joy and peace He had to offer me. It was right there, but I was a very immature Christian. My lowest point was not while in that life-threatening situation where I cried out to the Lord. That wasn't the lowest point. My lowest point was when I let a bad situation and circumstance, a divorce, to influence me to choose to leave the church, stop singing, stop praising God, and stop reading His Word. And I even stopped praying. My lowest point was when I turned my back on Jesus after all He had brought me through up till that point. I chose the world instead. The bad stuff that followed was merely an expected consequence. Reaping was what I was sowing into a sinful living and turning my back on God. How many of us know that we cannot escape the natural law of reaping what we sow? If we sow evil, we can expect to reap consequences. Maybe not immediately, but it will catch up. But God was merciful again. I did not die. We don't know if and when we may have that opportunity to turn to God or to turn back to Him, because really we don't know when our next breath is coming, if it's coming. He did give me that opportunity, and I am forever grateful. As I recovered, as in Joel 2, verse 25, God restored and He replaced the years of bad living with years of right living in Him, more and better choices. And I'm not yet where I want to be, but thank God I am not where I used to be. What do you see in that story? I see God working in our lives even when we're still messy, even when we don't realize or acknowledge it. He is love. He is good. I see free will operating in the life of a young believer at age 22. That, as a Christian woman, she faced many temptations and trials, and she chose to focus on her problems, on the world, more than on Jesus. She had at her fingertips all the love, resource, and strength that she would need. But did she go there? She looked at the world, not to Him. How many of us can relate to this story at one time or another in your life? Was she lukewarm or was she cold? We know that she was not on fire for the Lord. At any moment, God could have taken her out, given up on her. He could have gotten fed up and spewed her out of his mouth, as our Creator can do. Well, I know you know that I'm talking about myself, but I'm also talking about so many other people in the same situation and making the same choices. Are we ready to transform, to renew our minds and renew our hearts, our focus from the world to of worldly things and focus on Jesus? I always like to encourage listeners to accept Jesus if they've not done so already. It's the most important decision that we can make. It's actually a life and death situation for us. Here are some powerful scriptures about salvation. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God's unconditional love for us, that he would give his only begotten Son. And Jesus alone can make a difference in each of our lives. And each person must make that personal decision on their own because we have free will. In John 14:6, Jesus said himself, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. In Romans 10:9, we learn that when we confess that Jesus is the only begotten Son, and he came to pay for our sins, and we believe in our hearts that Jesus defeated death, we are saved. Whether you've already accepted Jesus or not, let's pray this together. Dear Jesus, I know that you are the only begotten Son of God, and I know that you suffered on the cross for me. You rose from the dead. Jesus, I am hopeless without you. I am a sinner, and I ask you to please forgive me. I repent of my sins. I walk away from my sinful life, and I ask you, Lord, to come into my heart and be my Lord and Savior all of the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. If you made that decision today and you prayed this prayer with me, believing and accepting Jesus, then you're saved, born again, you are a believer. In Romans 12:2, the Apostle Paul encourages us, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. The world's popular view we live in is without God. The perception is that we're self-made, self-sufficient, and we're prideful. We determine our future, but we actually cannot. Like I said before, we don't know our next breath. We are dependent on the Lord, whether we choose to admit it or not. Conviction and repentance brings opportunity to change our mindset, and we accept Jesus, sealing our relationship with him. We transform our focus from the world to Jesus. We've made that decision, a renewing of our minds and our hearts. We're in the world, but not of it. Our focus is on him. Our greatest love is no longer ourselves, our wealth, our success, our sinful living, but now we can focus on Jesus. In Matthew 22, verse 37 through 39, Jesus said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Because we have changed and transformed, we desire to sow good seed. The fruit of the Spirit is in us. The spiritual gifts are available to us. We are equipped with all that we need to fulfill our purpose, our calling. As we love our neighbors, we share the good news, the gospel of Jesus, and we help those in need. We trade in our selfishness, our materialism, our pride, our lust, our evil ways. and we trade them in for learning the truth and the Word of God, which is the Word of God, right living, praying, praising, and thanking God. And we enjoy that. Our heart loves it. We are His, and His Holy Spirit dwells in us to guide us, act as intercessory between us and the Father. And we are never alone. We see great plans. He gives us dreams and desires in our hearts and minds. Those who love God, and then ourselves and others, will find inner peace and joy and abundant life, a hope for a future everlasting with Jesus. Be you transformed. Be by renewal. You know, as in our Christian walk, we are ever changing and growing and maturing. Well, I want to encourage you to travel your own Christian walk. There may be detours and potholes along the way, like I've experienced, but quickly call out for God's help. He is our refuge and our strength in times of trouble. Follow Jesus in all that you do and study God's word. Obey and praise the Lord. Enjoy abundance in His calling, His purpose in your life. You won't be wondering, what am I here for? What am I doing? You will know. The meek, the humble shall inherit the earth and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. That's in Psalm 37, verse 11. Well, I hope you enjoyed my podcast today. This is Turn to God with Carin, and I pray that you all, you and me, are encouraged to and better equipped as we continue our journey, our individual paths together. This is Carin Jane Casey, author, speaker, domestic violence advocate, and ambassador for Christ. Stay tuned for Abundant Living with Carin every Tuesday morning at 7, and also Turn to God with Carin every Monday morning at 6:30. Both are Eastern Standard Time, and you can download the podcast anytime. And also, you can Google the podcast by name on the internet. Just simply Google Turn to God with Carin, C-A-R-I-N, or Abundant Living with Carin. Both of these podcasts are with Storm Talk 365 Radio, and we're available on iTunes, Twitter, and Alexa on Amazon, hosted by iHeartRadio and Spotify. My website is carinjanecasey.com, C-A-R-I-N-J-A-Y-N-E-C-A-S-E-Y. And I would sincerely love for you to contact me. I appreciate any suggestions, any feedback. And I want to know your experience with this podcast. Maybe you'd like to share your story. Maybe you have a message that you'd like listeners to hear on my podcast. Again, my website is carinjanecasey.com. Before closing, I want to share with you about my favorite nonprofit, Yeshua's House, Y-E-S-H-U-A. And it's pronounced Yeshua. Yeshua is the Hebrew name for Jesus. Well, Yeshua's House is a faith-based 18-month safe haven for women and their children coming from domestic violence and financial hardship. As I mentioned in my podcast, I am a survivor and an advocate of domestic violence. So, of course, I'm interested in this kind of our organization. I've been on the board of directors for over 3 years, and I've helped facilitate in some of the support classes. So, as I indicated earlier, Yeshua's House is nonprofit, and so they depend on donations. They're all tax deductible. They are in the most need for monthly pledge donations. Checks can be sent to Yeshua's House, Post Office Box 143, Petersburg, Virginia, 23804. Or you can donate on PayPal at the website, and that's yeshuashouse.net. Again, that's Y-E-S-H-U-A-S house.net. The founder, Angela Brown, can be contacted directly at the email address yeshuashouse2, refuge@gmail.com. yeshuashousetorefuge@gmail.com, or you can call 804-605-3841. My voice shall you hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning I will direct my prayer to you and look up. That's Psalms 5, verse 3. Thank you, and God bless.